Where would we go? Would there be a place to go if comet fragments hit the planet? That is the question. And the answer is, of course, there could be multiple places to go. For instance, I remember Baird Spaulding, teachings from masters of the Far East, said that he met these ETs in the Himalayan mountains, and they lived inside the mountains, actually. They brought him into their dwelling quarters inside mountains, and they had hollowed out these areas inside mountains. They had big halls, big areas, just everything. That was their cities inside mountains. And he said, when you look at the mountain, all you see is the stones and the mountain. You have no idea that it's actually a dwelling place for these ETs inside the mountain. Totally disguised, nobody could tell. So the fact is, actually, that let us say comet fragments hit the Earth, as I suspect they will. I suspect four will hit the Earth. Okay, we'll be hit by four cometary fragments. It is possible that there are vast underground dwelling places on this planet, that they've been set up ahead of time for this. It's possible. And that we can simply go into these mountains, go underground, where we're protected from the dust, where there's a whole sanitary ecosystem, as it were, set up, and you can dwell in there until the dust subsides, until the fires burn out, etc. That is very possible, and I believe that many will do that. That's what I've seen in one of my dreams. I saw that people went underground and into mountains, as it were. There is also the possibility that there are these very large floating bodies, motherships we call them, that are truly vast. I don't know how big they are. Could be 1,000 miles, you know, in diameter or something. Large. Or even more. But that's pretty large. That's like a planet, you know, some type of small planetary body or something. And they have cities, dwelling places that are beautiful, set up in this biosphere, as it were. Floating, a vast floating biosphere that is set up specifically to rescue people from this planet under the circumstance of a hit by comet fragments, bringing severe dust, fires, extinction level event type of situation. So there's that second possibility. Third possibility is people could shift dimensions, and through some sort of cosmic stargate, as it were, we could simply emerge into another dimension, another locale, etc. That there's the Earth could sort of vibrationally go into two different vibrations, two different Earths, as it were, as a possibility. Those on the new Earth would not experience the comet problem, and those on the old Earth would experience it. There's I've heard that many believe that will happen, actually. If you look at the smiley face, do I have a smiley face here? No, but you know the smiley face, the two dots and I've always felt that there was some symbol of the smiley face. It's very important. They're trying to teach the world. When that smiley face showed up is when the ETs basically showed up here in the world. And you saw that smiley face just everywhere, and it continues on. It's a very potent symbol. I don't know anything that has quite been as strong as that simple smiley face. And you look at the smiley face like that, it could the mouth could symbolize a comet slingshotting around the sun. Okay, it really could. The trajectory of a comet would take a parabolic severe slingshotting, a hairpin turn around the sun, as it were, strong whip around the sun. And the two eyes, what could those symbolize? They could actually symbolize two planets. The planet Earth splitting into two planets, two dimensions. So this is, again, a very, you know, potent possibility. The fourth, I would say, is a relocation to another planet via orbs or some sort of, you know, celestial, spiritual evacuation, as it were. We talk about transportation, some sort of transportation that is able to go into hyperspace in some way and take us, some way take us to another dwelling place, an evacuation, as it were, an exodus from the planet, from this planet. That's another possibility. This sort of goes along with the rapture of Christianity, and that's been around now, where people are taken off of the planet in some spiritual way and move to a far more beautiful place. Relocation, as I call it. That's a relocation. So you have these four different possibilities. The going into the Earth, mothership, the Earth splitting into two, relocation to another system, rapture, and the fifth one, I would say, is people. Some people just dimensionally shifting into a higher dimension somehow, where they just their body somehow they are a dimensional shift happens for them somehow, and they leave. They're gone. This is another take on the rapture, sort of different rapture A and rapture B, so to speak. So you have at least five possibilities. Five bona fide possibilities that people have been talking about for quite some time now. It's toned itself down, actually, quite a bit over the recent years, actually. It was, so there was a time when all of this was just going very strong. But I was certainly very much part of all of that time. As far as paying attention to these options. Recently, it's toned way down. And I think, I don't know what exactly the problem is. I think people are a little bit in shock, not saying so much in terms of these possibilities, for whatever reason. But we can still talk about it here, actually. So it's not like we're ignorant of these options. These options have been presented over the last 50 years, for sure, and actually last 2,000 years, talking about Jesus returning at the time of tribulation, time of troubles, the end times, and taking those who want to go with him, taking them to a place he's prepared for them to dwell there with him. That's been around for thousands of years. And we're told that it will come a time like a thief in the night. The problems will come like a thief in the night. Well, what could be more a thief in the night than when the world goes through the debris trail, the tail of this comet Ison, and suddenly rocks come in at 400,000 miles an hour? I mean, how long does it take for a rock to, you know, come in and hit the planet at that speed? I don't know. It would happen like a thief in the night, wouldn't it? Totally unexpected. I mean, these rocks would not have to be big. We're under this impression that we're all safe because we have these near-Earth object warning systems in place that we can find the asteroid, you know, before they get to us, etc. But you know, these rocks don't have to be very big to be problematical. So are we really able to identify in the trail of this, like a comet like this? Rocks the size of a car or smaller, basketball or whatever, you know, traveling at that speed, you know, I kind of doubt it. And how much warning would we have if we did notice, were able to actually notice one, how much warning would we really have at that kind of speed, you know? And what good would the warning do? I mean, would we be able to intercept it at that kind of speed, 400,000 miles an hour? Could we intercept it? Do we have anything that could really intercept it? It's really problematical, actually. So that is why I would say that people are very, you know, feeling very sober about, like, what's going to happen really in the world? And what is my destiny really going to be? And, you know, what are our options? And so people are, you never know what the defenses are and how people are going to, are reacting, etc. Maybe go into denial. I mean, denial seems to be the mode of the day. where people are just saying, hopefully nothing will happen. If I don't think about it, it won't happen. As a kind of a denial. If I don't think about it, it's not going to happen. So it's worth talking about because we have at least five options, and there are probably a lot more that I haven't, you know, thought about. There could also be living quarters set up under the oceans too. I mean, very possible. But there are actually cities under the ocean that have been set up for refugees as a safe place deep under the, you know, under the ocean. That's possible. I know a lot of ETs have their ships go into the ocean, are able to go into the ocean, under lakes, under the ocean. I know the Russians have been aware of this. They've been aware of a lot of stuff, actually. So there's another option. There's plenty of options, but the worst option probably would be to continue to be living here as we are now, with potential of severe dust. What I've seen, lived through in a dream, was severe dust is the problem. The problem really is going to be dust. That could be from combination of fires, volcanic eruptions, impact with Earth, kicking up massive dust cloud. You know, a lot of different factors, and can circulate the dust around the world, blot out the sun. They say they have 3 days of darkness. Well, in the Bible, days refer to different things. It could refer to years, actually. It could be 3 years of darkness, actually. Something like that. It's very possible. Where even the plants fail. And it's interesting right now, isn't it, that they've suddenly, Sergey Brin, or whatever his name is, from Google, has cooked up this test tube hamburger. That should get your attention, right? When we talk about perhaps people disappearing under the earth, into the mountains, underground, etc., you say, how are they going to eat? You know, what do they eat? Well, now you have the answer. I've known all for a long time that the extraterrestrials use nutrient broths, new types of nutrient baths, to grow food. This is something Baird Spaulding pointed this out, I believe. It was a life and teaching of the masters of the Far East or something like that. It's just so it's no surprise. They simply can grow beef in laboratories. They don't need the cows. They just need the stem cells and the technology to do it. And I guarantee you now, you wonder what all those abductions of cows were all about. In the United States, all this horrible, you know, vivisections of cattle taking stuff. And the extraterrestrials obviously were collecting stem cells, they're collecting various types of material from the cows so that they can grow food, grow beef in laboratories, as it were. That's part of it. So now we have this announcement today that Mr. Brin has been working on this. Oh, big surprise, you know. Big surprise, huh? So, there. Put two and two together. Put two and two together that this comes out now. And they're going to, you know, for people that might go underground, they're going to say, hey, don't worry, we've got plenty of beef. We've got all the beef you can want. Well, we got even a McDonald's down there. We've got plenty of McDonald's and Burger Kings and stuff, all the fast food you want. He said, wait, was that possible? Where's the cows? There's no grass, there's no grazing. What do you can't, we can't grow stuff on the surface. Well, how do you do that? No, we just, chemically, we grow the stem cells. They got the chemicals. They have the technology how to do that. And they can grow all sorts of food that way, right? All sorts of proteins, all sorts of meat products, maybe vegetable products, etc. They can just grow it underground. So that's a big time attention getter today, folks. Just put two and two together of what's going on, actually. We know the underground situation is there to some extent. I don't believe we know to what extent. It's probably way more extensive than we know. We're talking about these biospheres. Well, how do they get food there, you know? Well, I think the biospheres are so large, you can grow food hydroponically or lots of different ways. But they also can grow in laboratory stuff. But it also, you can also manifest food in spiritual situations. You can just manifest food. And you wouldn't be manifesting meat. If you're really spiritual, you don't eat meat. You don't eat muscle. You don't eat that stuff. You can just manifest whatever you need to eat. An orange, fruit, whatever grain, milk products, maybe, I don't know. But you can simply manifest. And in higher dimensions, you simply absorb the thought forms of food into your system. Absorb the idea of nutrition into your system. And there's all sorts of different ways to go about it, actually. But we have now reached the point here on August 6, 2013, with, I would say, as significant an announcement as we've had in a long time, because it should trigger in you the recognition, uh-oh, this is, it's on. It's really on. Because they now are telling, hey, guess what, folks, we can grow beef in laboratories. And pretty soon, they say, you'll be able to eat this beef. They're getting the pump, they're getting people ready for various situations, actually. Not an easy topic to deal with here, but that's our job, is to tackle the tough ones. So we're waiting for part two of this video to unfold. If there is a part two. Right now I am preparing to go on a trip to, again, a most incredibly beautiful place. And I'm just starting to gear up for that and think in that way. You know, just little things that you haven't thought about, just doing that. Get extra bug fluid so you don't run out of wiper fluid to get all those bugs off your windshield. I got extra bug fluid. Digital pressure gauge so I can check the air of the tires, which I just didn't. They were all too low and off, you know. You can't trust the gauges in gas stations, nor can you trust the ones, sliding ones so much. The new digital pressure gauges for your tires are pretty amazing. Really very amazing. I recommend, you know, if you're traveling, get one of those $10 at O'Reilly's. Getting some extra memory cards, 32 gig memory cards for the camera. I need to order another battery. Getting some food. I'm going to have to keep amping up everything. So this is like a test run, so to speak, of going to a better place. The issue is now is moving to a better place. So we should be getting in shape a little bit. I'm trying to shake, get the rust off, you know, of being able to move a little better. It's not going too quickly. I don't know if I should start running, if that's smart or not. But fact is, we need to feel like, yeah, we're somewhat competent of relocating in some way, because it may well be necessary. If you read the tea leaves, the political tea leaves, and see who's starting to be in charge now, if you haven't picked up a pattern yet, you know, maybe you're a little bit slow, but you know, you still can, but it's pretty doggone obvious what's going on. Who's just appointed the UN ambassador, the UN to the United States? Just pay attention to stuff like that. You know, there's a reason for all of this. There's a reason for control. they feel they may need to put people in various places, etc. And I'm just noticing that. I'm just noticing. Aha. Look at that. Very interesting. Who ordered the stand down in Benghazi, for instance? Who ordered that? You know, there's another question for you. Who has the authority to say no to the military and tell the military to stand down? Who exactly did that? You know what I mean? You just pay attention to that. But that's very significant stuff that's going on, actually. We've been conditioned as a society, actually, to listen to a certain voice of authority now that we cannot backtalk to not question. Now, who is it? What is that? That's a pretty simple question. Who have we been conditioned to not backtalk to? Just look at that conditioning. And then to see, are those people now being put in places of power and authority in the world? And so you realize, if they tell us to do something, we're going to have a hard time saying no to that. Now, of course, I can say no to it individually, but can I do it under the pressure of the collective? Maybe not. Maybe not. So let's stay humble about the situation. I mean, humility is your greatest strength right now. So we try to be honest in these videos and truly humble. And I say, I can do it individually, but if the collective may get the better of me. Therefore, it's probably better to escape the collective at this time. Because I can tell you that the voice of the collective right now is going to be very difficult to resist. Very difficult to resist. It's all been programmed that way. We've been indoctrinated for this. And the sirens, when they sing their song, very difficult to resist. And we all say, I can do it. Not necessarily. When you're getting pressure from all your family, all your friends, all your community neighbors, all your community, all your state, country, planet, etc., etc., when you get this massive collective pressure, who can really just brush that off? I don't think I could. So that puts me in a great position, realizing the vulnerability, and say, I am very, very keen, but I know my limitations, you know. As Clint Eastwood said, a man, and we can say anyone, we've got to know our limitations. Very important. The keener and the wiser you are, the better you're able to be aware of potential limitations that you might have. And so I see one coming up for everybody. In the Bible it says that the end times will be, the pressure, the peer pressure will be so intense at the end times that even the elect of God will be in vulnerability of being pulled down, into obedience and submission to what they ought not to submit to. And so that's, I see that as a distinct possibility, which necessitates a retreat from the consensus. A retreat from what? The global community, which is under the spell of these chosen ones whose voices are supposed to be unimpeachably submitted to. As if to atone for some guilt. The ego has set that all up very cleverly. But just because you see it doesn't mean you're not going to be vulnerable to it. I remember back in, what was it, 1998 or something, I was watching television. The Holy Spirit said, it's time. You've got to stop. And I said, don't worry. I can see through all this stuff that they're doing. And the Holy Spirit says, but you don't understand the bigger picture of the pressure. And you will submit to it if you don't stop now. And I said, wow, you don't have faith in me, huh? That's pretty amazing. But I said, I'll put faith in you, but I don't know. I feel like I should be able to handle it. But now in hindsight, I look and I say, wow, the Holy Spirit was right. The Holy Spirit was right. So once again, we're at the bridge where the Holy Spirit may tell us, hey, you need to retreat from the body politic of the planet, as it were, because the consensual pressure, the pressure brought to bear upon you from all angles will crush you. And I may say, I understand the whole situation, but then I say, wait a minute, I better follow the Holy Spirit's advice, you know, and swallow my pride. And then in hindsight, I'm sure looking back, I'll say, the Holy Spirit was right. What a mess. What an absolute mess. I was driving home on the freeway yesterday, and there's this massive traffic jam going the opposite direction, going north. And I said, there's got to be a bad accident. And indeed, there was. And I just got a glimpse of it as I was driving, just to determine, was there an accident? And what I saw after I caught a glimpse, I just drove straight. I didn't look anymore. I'm not a rubbernecker. Our lanes going south were very slow, too, because everybody was rubbernecking, of course. But what I saw was, like, the worst accident I've ever seen. This car was, like, had completely upside down and just crushed like a pancake and burned and just completely burned and gutted. I mean, it was just like, it was horrible. Nobody could survive. It's just unbelievable what happened to that car. I don't know. Single car accident like that is just amazing. So there again, you know, that there's some foreshadowing of things to come. And the rubbernecking could be severe, and you get stuck in the traffic jam. You say, it's not going in my direction. It's going, but, you know, the direction that we were going in was almost as slow as the direction going the other way, where the accident was, because everybody was slowing down, stopping the rubberneck. And they say, oh my God, look at that. Oh, wow. They slow down to, you know, 5 miles an hour, and it causes a chain reaction, the whole traffic jam. So just because we may be going in the right direction, as it were, not where the accident was, doesn't mean it's not going to be all jammed up. Rubberneckers. Now, I don't rubberneck, but one of the few that who do not do that is, I don't need to see anything. You know, fire truck's there, ambulance, everything's there, whatever. Okay, it's an accident. Whoopee. All right, we know it's an accident. It's a big deal. Let's just keep driving, folks. You know, haven't you ever seen an accident before? Is a question. So, boy, the foreshadowing is just awful. And of course, 9/11 caught us by surprise. We're under the impression that we're such good people. Nothing bad could happen to us. How can anything bad happen to us? We're so smart, we're so sophisticated. Anything bad that's going to happen to us, we're going to know about it, okay, right in advance. Well, what about 9/11? Didn't that catch most everybody by surprise? It didn't catch me by surprise because I was warned about it in a dream. And I knew pretty much that there was going to be a totally surprise sneak attack by airplanes on the United States, and it was going to cause, you know, terrible situation. I didn't know all the specifics at all, but I knew the basics 3 years before it even happened. So it doesn't necessarily catch everyone by surprise, but there's reasons why people don't want to know the future. There's various reasons. I'm not going to get into it, but the delusion that somehow stuff like this can't happen to us, that is just the most incredible delusion, really. An amazing arrogance and insanity to think that way. Because again, there isn't anyone here. There is no I. There is no self. There isn't. It's a presumption. There is this dance of defenses against the continuity problem. And this whole thing is a training program for death anyway. So the idea that somehow there's some good peoples here somewhere is not true. It's not true. There's nobody good here. There's nobody here at all, really. It's just a massive web of defenses and insanity and ways of trying to avoid the continuity problem, actually. And at the same time, learn how to die. So, of course, we think that these so-called human beings, that we think there's a person here, there's not, is good. So nothing bad can happen to these human forms. It is insanity, ludicrous. You would expect bad stuff to happen, actually. So the fact that nobody's expecting any problem from a comet doesn't mean it's not going to happen. But we, most people believe that. Well, most people didn't expect 9/11 to happen either, and it happened, right? Most people didn't expect the tsunami, Japanese tsunami to happen, and it happened. Now, these are wake-up calls. I think the tsunami was there was a comet around that time too, wasn't there? Some sort of celestial alignment and also a comet or something. Cosmos is a very much a dynamic that we don't understand yet. So the defense, like, well, nobody believes it's going to come. We're all good people. Nothing like that's going to happen to us. No way. It is folly, stupidity. Don't trust in that idea. I mean, I'm sure those people on a train in Spain said, "We're just on a vacation here. Nothing bad can happen to us. We're just out to have some fun. How can anything bad happen to us?" There's so much foreshadowing. It's unbelievable in my life. Just unbelievable. Like I said, I was at this beautiful resort. Beautiful, incredible day. Maybe one of the most beautiful days of my life. It was surreal how beautiful the situation was. I leaving it, and then that's the accident. Terrible, terrible accident. This rust-red Volkswagen Beetle gone around a turn too fast. Hairpin turn type of thing. Too fast. Flipped over. Rolled over and threw out its four occupants, and one was in critical condition, one was in serious condition, and two were in traumatized by it, but apparently not in serious or critical condition. But four get thrown out of this Volkswagen bug around a hairpin turn. Okay, and when that happened, I said, this is a foreshadowing of what's going to come. It's a foreshadowing, for sure. I had a spiritual knowledge of this. And what happened? I went, called 9/11, waited till they came, everything okay, went back up to the resort, and just hung out there, and just in the beauty up there, and just relaxed and waited for it to all clear out. That's what I did. So that's what I believe is going to happen. There's going to be a situation, and there will be those who just, you know, retreat from it and wait until it's, you know, calmed down. But again, the four planes in 9/11, the four people get thrown out of this Volkswagen Beetle, don't have their seatbelts on, going too fast around a hairpin turn. Spanish train going too fast around a turn. A guy in Venice Beach making a quick, you know, hairpin turn as it, and then mowing down the people. It's just like there's so much stuff going on. I've had many, many, many other foreshadowings, including again in my birthplace. A huge sculpture of a flaming comet is now resting on that place, and just amazing. I said, wow. And again, we all say it's not possible because nobody believes us, and we're all such good people that if it were true, we'd all be warned. that's the funny thing. Well, we weren't warned about 9/11. I knew about the Indonesian tsunami, and I tried for 6 months to warn the world. Nobody, not a soul listened. Not a one soul listened. I think at that point I just gave up. I didn't want to know about the Japanese tsunami. I wasn't aware of it. Maybe I just blocked it out because I said it's futile. If you know, even if you knew about that, if you tried to warn the world, nobody would listen. That is a fact. I've been through that many, many times. And after a while, I said, just give up. Say, forget it. It's not even worth it. So the idea is that if such a thing was true, we'd all be warned. It is just utter arrogance. Madness just to think that. And I see why. I understand why that is. People, there's a reason why. And it has to do with, well, it would take quite an explanation. I've explained in other videos to a certain extent. But given the choice between the fear of being destroyed by a comet and the problem the comets would bring, which most people wouldn't be destroyed right away, but the dust problem will cause great problems with civilization and people, etc. But given that, or the idea of eternal disorientation in reality, the continuity problem, which is a greater fear? It's a no-brainer. The greater fear is the fear about eternal disorientation by immeasurably. So when people, when you try to warn them, it actually starts to diminish their defensiveness and start thinking about how terrible the world is, and then they actually start feeling the loathing they have for this place, and then they feel like, hey, I want to drop this whole training program, and then the continuity fear arises for them, okay? And they say, oh my gosh, that's overwhelming. And then they say, oh, comment, I don't care about it. That's no big deal, no big deal. And then, since it's no big deal, I don't want to think about it. That's it, see, blocked out. Because I say that's nothing compared to the fear I have over the eternal disorientation. Absolutely nothing. So comet comes, world's wiped out, civilization collapses, I die. So what? No big deal. I don't even need to think about that. See, people, we want to, because of our great fear of eternal disorientation, what's called the continuity problem, because this training program of death is so dissimilar to reality, we're afraid that we won't know how to function or be there at all. So we'd be disoriented. That fear is so vast, so great, so terrifying that people are desperate to avoid this issue altogether, and so they're focused on trying to believe that this world can be their home. So if you tell them, hey, a comet's coming, it's going to make this world, can't be your home anymore, they're going to say, ah, no way, no way, no way, no, it's not possible, can't happen. No, because that brings up the continuity problem for them. Like, I need to maybe return to reality. Or, this world's a terrible place. Why am I even attached to it? You know, I don't want it anymore. And then, ooh, you know, I have to go straight home? Uh-oh, too much fear. So, you can't really tell people about bad situations that are going to happen. They cannot entertain that and at the same time defend against the continuity problem. They cannot. So they have to choose one or the other. For me, I decided the continuity problem, the Holy Spirit has resolved it. And I've experienced that, and I trust the Holy Spirit, so it's no problem for me. Not much. Therefore, I can entertain being told about these future events, and it doesn't bother me. I don't deny it. I say, yeah, you're probably right. Probably right. Yeah, the world's a terrible place. This place is a place of death. It's a death trap here. But I'm not afraid of the continuity problem so much. I trust the Holy Spirit has resolved it perfectly, and I don't have to worry about it directly going back to reality. There's this intermediate step of everything appearing perfectly lovely every second without exception. And that loveliness reminds us of reality so much, then we can drop perception altogether, so it's not a problem. Therefore, I can see these things to some extent. Whereas most people, no way. Because it would make them loathe the world. If they thought a comet was coming, they'd say, that is so horrible. I hate this world. I hate everything about it. I want to drop it right now. And they say, oh my gosh, I'm staring at eternal disorientation. And they say, I can't do that. That's worse. Okay, what comet? There's no comet. This world's wonderful. Nothing's going to happen. Everything's going to be fine. Go into that mode. So there's nothing you can do. You know, even if you knew everything that was going to happen and you could warn people, they wouldn't listen to you. And that's been my testimony my whole life. I used to know all the bad stuff. I used to know what was going to happen. But I, through so many instances of telling people, I just got such terrible backlash. And they just hated me. They just hated it. And I said, wow, they don't want to know. They kind of do. But when you tell them, they say, I can't deal with that. I don't want to know. Get out of here. I don't want to listen to you anymore. Just stay away from me. Stay away from me. That kind of thing. It's like, whoa. You become persona non grata. So it's because they this dynamic of the continuity problem, they have to put their faith in existence, this impermanence of being a great place. They got to believe it. Otherwise, their defenses start crumbling, and they start feeling this continuity problem and the fear. And if they don't have faith in the Holy Spirit, and they don't have the desire, determination to work through these issues, then they're going to veer back into denial. Plain and simple. Plain and very simple situation, actually. So I could tell you exactly what's going to happen with the comet, I mean, the information is there, I'm sure, but nobody would believe it. Nobody would, you know, want to hear it. And I'm pretty aware of the basics of it, but more than that, you know, what's the use? What's the use? Just float out here some basics to people, and if they are able to handle this possibility, handle it, then they can handle it. But I will say the foreshadowing is extraordinary. And I'm sure everybody's aware of some foreshadowing in their lives, that they're starting to notice events and say, well, there's a pattern here to these events. Some kind of pattern here. And the uptick is extreme right at this point. It's been going on for quite some time, but now it's really becoming obvious, right? It's like, my gosh, a really big attack is coming, a really big one, you know. Well, that's another foreshadowing, isn't it? So, and yet people say, oh, no, the world's fine. It's a wonderful place. I love this place. Love it. The more that people loathe this world, the more they pretend to love it. Because they're terrified of the continuity issue, and they don't want to admit that they loathe it. So they overcompensate and talk about how wonderful this is. So, well, let me give you a hug. You know, Leo Buscali, just humanity, I just love you so much. Let me give you a hug. And you know, everybody just hug each other and tell how much we love each other. Everything's going to be great. You know, this is just great. Love the world, love people, love our situation here. It's just wonderful. Could stay here forever. That's severe overcompensation. For inside, they just feel this complete disconnect from this world. I just want to completely disidentify, be detached from it entirely. And they say, oh, I won't know how to function maybe in reality, so let me embrace everything. Let me embrace, you know, it's overcompensation. Like, I don't have that. I don't have any feeling of like needing to embrace people or the world or anything like that. Occasionally that comes up when the insecurity gets higher. You have a feeling of just want to pat people on the back. How you doing? But that goes away pretty quickly. It's a sign of severe insecurity. But usually I don't have any feeling like that at all of needing to embrace the world. Say, ah, world, you're so wonderful. No, there's no need for that. So it all boils down to the continuity issue. How strong is our fear? And of course we all have fears about that. It's just how strong is it? So I still have fears about that, absolutely. It hasn't vanished completely. It doesn't need to vanish completely to at least go in the right direction. Now you want to walk out of the graveyard. If you're walking out of the graveyard, you know, you might still feel, this place is spooky. But I know I'm walking out of it. Where somebody else is walking into it, deeper and deeper into the graveyard. You know, that's not the right direction to go. And they may start whistling and singing a song and say, hey, I love this direction, you know. And this is great. Hey, everybody, let's clap our hands. And, you know. But it's... overcompensation. They may be saying, I hate this place. It's getting worse and worse. I want to get out of here. But I'm afraid if I do, I'll just run so fast, I'll just jump right back into, I'll jump into reality, and I won't know how to function. So it takes a real sober kind of discerning, serious approach so you don't get caught in these overcompensation, swings of overcompensation. You have to level it out. Level the path out. And just... you don't want to swing towards, I hate the world, I hate the world. And then, oh, I love the world, I love the world. Like, I've got to find something in the world. And then, oh, I hate the world's terrible. You know, you see these people, they swing back and forth. Whereas it's better to just remain very calm, very skeptical, cynical, skeptical, but in a discerning, objective kind of way, where you say, I know the world's terrible, but let me just look, you know, okay, I'm not going to react to that, and I'm not going to overcompensate for it, and just stay very level, even keel. And that, then your path goes much, much quicker when you're able to do that. So all these people are, you know, yelling at the politicians and stuff like that. Yeah, of course that's all bad. I mean, okay, it's a given. The world's terrible, okay? But don't get into that, because what will happen is you'll get to a point where you say, I just want to throw it all away right now, forever. And then the continuity fear will hit you, and then you'll start looking for, you know, your next lover or something. What is it that I want to love here? And I guess I want to grab everything and love everything, because, I'm so afraid of this, you know, disorientation that I'm presuming would happen. And then you get entangled in the world again. So that's not the way. So when you see how terrible the world is, say, okay, well, how did I get entangled in it? You know, let me see if I can see the way I'm entangled, what's holding me here, why am I afraid to accept the Holy Spirit's new perception, new mode of perception? Why am I afraid of that? Why am I resisting that? And you stay on an even keel, even though the rhetoric may be that you don't like the world. You're not indulging in hatred of it. I don't feel any hatred towards the world or anything. Everything is on a mental higher level, as it were, of just an objective fact that it's futile. It's an attempt to teach ourselves how to die. It's insane. It's all these terrible things. But that's just it. It's just what it is. It is what it is. So there's no reason to, you know, react to it. It is what it is. The answer is, what is the remedy? That's the only question. What is the remedy? And certainly, embracing the world is not the remedy. So, you know, you say, let's rule that one out. So I tend to be very detached, very aloof, very detached, very self-contained. When I go out, I don't really look at people. I'm not a people watcher anymore at all. I say, look, it's a person. You know, it's just a person. You don't want to look at people. There's no reason to look at people. I say, yes, true. So just people are walking here. Just let them walk. Let people do what they're doing. There's no reason to pay attention to people, really. So the attention is really smooth, detached. Of course, I'm very affable in the appropriate situations, you know, but not overly so. I mean, it's just whatever's socially appropriate. You know, hi, how are you? And thank you very much. The grocery store, and it's just polite and civil and stuff. But other than that, just very detached from everything that's going on. Not in a withdrawn way, but an intelligent way. Just saying, it's too late for all this stuff. You know, this stuff has no answer for me whatsoever. I know I need a new mode of perception. Doesn't matter what I perceive. If the perceiving is being done by that which is impermanent, and vulnerable and unstable, distorted lens, there's no way that you can, that's going to solve the continuity problem. Doesn't matter what you're looking at. Doesn't matter. So, sort of just that sort of attitude. Of course, it's not a highly social attitude at all. But I'm not antisocial either. I don't feel much antisocial feelings. I just don't have much feeling at all, really, one way or the other for the world. I'm not invested in feeling. If I ask myself, how do I feel about the world? I don't feel anything towards the world. One way or the other, it's irrelevant. Because everything that you're feeling is coming through distorted, this perception, which is totally, it's just distortion. It's a hallucination. We're all hallucinating, actually. Perception is hallucination. Now, it is true that the Holy Spirit's perception is also hallucination. However, it's a pragmatic hallucination that solves the continuity problem. All hallucination is meaningless to reality. All of it. So, it doesn't matter, really matter, how you see the world at all. It only matters that you solve the continuity problem be solved. That's the only issue we have. Everything else doesn't matter. So, your hallucination should be one that solves the continuity problem. It's just a no-brainer. So if a hallucination of loveliness is what does it, and it is, the Holy Spirit's hallucination, then by all means do it. What objection can we have? What objection could we possibly have to not do it? If you look at the objections, go through them carefully, you realize they're all bogus. They're all bogus. You know, God told me not to. It's all these nonsensical stuff. You really look at them, you say, well, that holds no water whatsoever. It's like a cup with its bottom is gone. You see a cup and you say, oh yeah, that'll hold water. And we check the bottom. Does it have a bottom? There's no bottom in that cup. How can it hold water? There's no bottom whatsoever to these objections. So it's important that people realize this attitude is possible even in these days. That it's possible to see things this way, to be this detached, to be this unconcerned, to say, you know, and to still be able to focus in on the truth even in the face of this comet coming in. Because we can't lose sight of the truth. And again, let us stress that all perception is hallucination. Totally. We're doing nothing but hallucinating. That's it. But can we have a useful hallucination? Yes. Yes, 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 yes. The Holy Spirit is a useful hallucination. It gives us a useful hallucination. Solves a continuity problem, continuity crisis. It solves it for us. So, very pragmatically useful. And that's the only basis on which to choose it, actually. Truly. That's the only real basis to choose the Holy Spirit's perception, is it solves a continuity problem. So we're just being utterly pragmatic here and straight talking. Let's not indulge in all this other stuff. Because otherwise you're going to get stuck. Because the ego is very smart. You got to be honest with the ego, as it were. You got to be honest with yourself in the situation. The ego cannot overcome that honesty. But if you start trying to play tricky with the ego, it's going to get you. Most definitely it's going to get you. So when you try to play the Holy Spirit up, oh no, the Holy Spirit's perception is real and all about, no, you're never going to make it. It is not real. It is hallucination. It's a meaningless hallucination. That's a fact. The ego can't argue that fact. Cannot. But it's a useful hallucination, and it can't argue that either. It's meaningless, but it's useful. And its usefulness gives it the only meaning that it has. Its usefulness gives it the only meaning that it has. There is no other meaning to it. But it eventually outlives its usefulness. And then the meaning becomes the fact that we no longer need perception at all. And then we can accept reality as it is, and without the fear that we can't function in it. We'll say, oh, I can function in that. Steadiness, effortless. It's steady perception and effortless, lovely loveliness. Spell, under the spell of the Holy Spirit's hallucination. That's all we have to do, fall under the spell of the Holy Spirit's hallucination. Steady perception, effortless, lovely loveliness. Spell, S-P-E-L-L. Just remember that spell. I want to fall under the spell of the Holy Spirit's perception. It is a spell. It is. But so is this perception. This perception's a spell too. It's just that we're used to it, so we don't think of it in terms of being a spell. But it is a spell. Very, very heavy spell. We're under a spell. Terrible spell, actually. Now, the Holy Spirit's also a spell, but it's not a terrible one. Because it's useful. Whereas this spell we're in now doesn't have any real use at all. It's useless. Not only is it meaningless, it's useless. Because we can't teach ourselves how to die, it's impossible. So it's a useless spell. So let's fall under the spell of the Holy Spirit. Stable perception, which is the key. Okay. Stable perception. What is the E? I forgot the E, but something lovely, loveliness. That is what we need. Fall under that spell. Stable perception, experiencing lovely, loveliness. hallucination.
Right.
So, there you go. There you get the facts of the situation. The ego cannot argue with that. What can I do? It is quiet. It just says, well, you don't need me anymore. That's what the ego... The ego's quiet. It says, yeah, you don't need me anymore. I mean, what goes quiet? What can go quiet? When you talk about enlightenment, so something went quiet. What can go quiet except the ego? Truth doesn't need to go quiet. It already is quiet. I mean, it already is. It doesn't go quiet. It's the ego. When you accept the facts, you don't need the ego anymore. So the ego just goes quiet. And it's like, there's no more need for it. So be honest, be humble, be honest, but be honest, and say, yeah, it is a hallucination. That takes the wind out of the ego's sails. Because there's no more argument, right? The ego hates it when you say, wait a minute, the Holy Spirit's real, and this isn't, and this is real perception, this is not real perception. And the ego says, wow, you know, that's not true, you're lying, and you get in all these arguments and stuff like that, and it's terrible. But when, if you just say the truth of the situation, it's simply pragmatic, you're not trying to say, present it as something that it isn't, then the ego's got nothing to grab a hold on. It's got nothing, and then it's quiet because it can't hook into you. You know, it's like you're a fish and there's no hooks in you. You're swimming and you think, oh, where's the ego? I don't experience anything. It's all quiet and calm because there's no way to hook into you. You don't need to be hooked anymore. You don't need to be hooked into avoiding the continuity situation. So you see that even though there is this comet racing toward us right now, and it could very well be the comet of doom, the perturber, we are still able to focus ever more clearly on the bigger picture, and not be overwhelmed by this. So, you know, I don't like doom for doom's sake. But if you're aware of what's to come and you use that to transcend, as it were, the whole context of the situation, then you've prepared properly. So it's almost like you really push back the fear, and it doesn't seem quite as significant as it did before. But if we don't do this, then we won't be able to, our minds will not be big enough to truly feel like we have distanced ourselves from the situation. We're able to distance ourselves. And therefore the situation will seem to be like a prison. And our minds will be bouncing off the walls. And then we'll get agitated. When we get agitated when our minds are bouncing off the walls, and we cannot see beyond a certain situation. But what we're talking about here, it transcends all definitions, all situations, all perceptions that we're having. It says that everything can be seen as perfectly lovely because it's all hallucination. So hallucinate a beautiful world where everything is simply effortlessly, exquisitely lovely. So that's the E, effortless. Stable perception, effortless, lovely, loveliness. The effortlessness is similar to reality. Stable perception, the stability, similar to reality. Effortlessness, similar to reality. Loveliness, similar to reality. See? So the similarity of this stable perception, effortless, lovely, loveliness, is you get used to that and you say, ah, this is very similar to reality, and then you can, the continuity problem has been overcome. So, whatever happens in the world, we still need to fall under the Holy Spirit's spell. Stable perception, effortless, lovely, loveliness. Double loveliness there, because that means there's this extra dimensional depth to it, as it were. It's just no end to the loveliness. It's not just lovely, it's lovely loveliness. That's important. Being made for it to be lovely. There's no effort being made for it to be lovely. It simply is. It just is lovely. There's no effort. It's not like something needs to happen for it to be lovely. It already is. It just is. It is lovely. Lovely, lovely. There's just lovely loveliness there everywhere. Without any effort. And it's stable. The perception of it is stable. The perceiving mechanism is stable. So we can talk about these things. And we realize that this stuff is more important than any comment. Is more important. Maybe that's why the martyrs could withstand their crucifixion, etc., because they knew that their focus transcended this death of the body entirely, so much so that the death of the body, while maybe it was regretful, or maybe it wasn't, you know, such a great thing, really, but he said, you know, it's just a drop, it's just a small little thing, but I see something that is so much more profound than whether this body is animated or not, that it doesn't even matter. It doesn't even matter. But that could also have been overcompensation on their part, too. But we're talking about something more significant than just the death of a body. We're talking about the death of a planet, the death of a civilization. And so in order to overcome that, you need something more. I mean, the death of one person, you say, oh, okay, I can get a bigger context on that. But what if this entire civilization collapses as if it never were and is gone, which is very possible? You know, how do you cope with that mentally? See, that's what I'm saying. You need something that is truly the big picture. Truly the big picture. And this is truly the big picture, what I'm presenting here. All of existence is just a training program trying to teach us how to die. It is all a hallucination. It has no meaning. It is utterly futile. No meaning whatsoever. The only problem we have one problem and only one, the continuity problem. It's a huge problem. God created the Holy Spirit to solve the continuity problem for us. The Holy Spirit hallucinates a stable perception of effortless, lovely loveliness for us. We see that, we perceive that, and that solves the continuity problem for us. But then we set down all perception, the whole training program, stop hallucinating entirely, and we're experiencing reality once again. It's that simple, and that encompasses anything, the entirety of any event that could possibly happen, the collapse of a planet, the collapse of the whole universe. All of that is just a trifle within this perspective. It's a trifle. Holy Spirit's in charge. We don't need to worry. We don't need to worry about any of that stuff. Because there's nothing that the Holy Spirit cannot present to us as a stable perception of effortless, lovely loveliness. Entirely, 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 entirely. And we just trust in that, and that dispels the fear, Which is very important now. I mean, I pray that there's a guru that shows up really at this time. We should pray that a guru shows up at this time, really. That just has that, you know, absolute certainty. And that reminds us, oh yeah, almost forgot. And then the fear is just pushed away, And it's as necessary at this time, because the fear otherwise is going to become a contagion. And you bounce off the walls, your perspective gets limited, bouncing off the walls, agitation, blame, projection, all these different defense mechanisms bumping into each other, at each other's throats, and all this kind of stuff, and it just is too much, So, I don't have an inside track on knowing what the gurus are going to do. I don't know. But nevertheless, we can get this feeling like, hey, We're not really trapped. any moment we could choose the Holy Spirit's hallucination. There isn't any other dynamic. It doesn't matter how we see the world. As far as, do we have to see it a certain way? No, only from a practical standpoint. But we don't have to see that tree as a tree. We don't have to see it the way we're seeing it right now. Not at all. It doesn't make any difference, you know, how we see this or that. It's all meaningless. Definitions are meaningless. All this impermanence is meaningless. But the Holy Spirit's perception, it has a practical aspect to it. To solve a continuity problem. Therefore, we can accept that. We say, wow, okay, I can accept that. That's acceptable. The rest of this stuff, forget it. The idea that they're supposed to see things a particular way is nonsense. And of course, everybody perceives things differently anyway. So we're not bound to the sensory perception. Not bound to that at all. That's just designed to try to teach us how to die. That's just the only purpose. And that's futile, so there's really no purpose at all. It's meaningless. It has a meaning. It's completely meaningless, actually. So eventually this will normalize in us, but it'll be great to have a real guru here to show that it's completely normalized in them. Completely. Completely. And then all you do is you soak that up. You say, wow, it's completely normalized in them. You just soak it up. It's completely normalized in them. Now, I could use a guru like Ananda Maimon and show you that, but there's a danger right now is because the voices of authority in the world that are going to tell us to submit to our fate are now actually feminine voices. That's the whole plan. That's what's happening. So if you put Ananda Maimon up there, that could very well augment the authority of all these feminine voices in the world who are going to tell us, civilization, to submit to its fate, which we absolutely reject. So it could very well boost their authority at this time. So that is why I'm not doing it. Not doing it. I could. I mean, I could do a fabulous job at that, but I've been told not to. It's Big Mother right now, actually, is the situation. And we didn't expect that. That's why we're more stuck than we think. You know, it's like, uh-oh. You know, it's easy to argue with Dad, but when Mother puts you, you know, tells you what to do, you're just like, submit, you know. They're trying to turn people into like children, really. This world is trying to turn people into like a childlike state, a low-information childlike state. So when the mother tells them what to do, they submit to it and do it, you know, without questioning it, so to speak. So the last thing I want to do is present this great mother, as it were, who truly told us the truth of what to do. Because people can easily twist that and say, oh yeah, we're supposed to do what the mother tells us what to do. And then the voice of the mother is coming through the reporters, the media, through the bureaucrats, now through high-ranking positions on the planet. More and more and more is the voice of the mother saying, we're telling you what to do now, and we don't want any back talk. You just do as Mom tells you to do. Don't worry, Mom. Mother knows best. Well, Mother doesn't know best. The Holy Spirit knows best. Holy Spirit's not Mother. And in fact, Ananda Maimon always objected to be called Mother. She said, I'm not Mother. Don't call me Mother. That's a very bad, she said, actually. She said, that's a problem for you. You know, I don't want to be seen as Mother. And they insisted on it. And she just said, well, it's not good for you. It's a problem for you. And she's right, of course. She says that creates a distance and authority problem and all this stuff. And it's just, don't see me that way. Just see me as a little child or your daughter or your friend, but not as a mother, okay? But that's not how people take her, you know. They Mother, I submit to you, Mother. I bow to you, Mother. They're preparing to submit and bow to the voices of authority and submission in the world, which is Big Mother, feminine voices, actually. It's becoming more and more apparent. Man, that's the tough one. When mom tells you what to do in an authoritative way, especially when you've been pressured to be dumbed down. And a lot of the agenda in the world right now is to dumb us down so that we're thinking like children. We're confused. We need guidance. We don't know what, you know, how to act, how to think, what conclusions to draw. Our conclusions are all backwards and upside down and confused. And then we see so vulnerable. It creates a vulnerability, it's a mental state of vulnerability. And then we become very vulnerable to the mother, to the voice of the mother, telling us, my children, this is what your mother is telling you to do, and I'm telling you, you must do it right now. And then this child, like, oh, okay, the only way I can be safe is to do what the mother is telling me to do. That's the plan. That is the plan. Submit to your fate, as it were. Which the training exercise in this world, of course, is to bring about as much training towards death as possible. And so it's not a good time to bring out Ananda Mahima, because people view her as the mother, as some like super authoritative mother who and then that gets transferred onto the feminine authority in the world, which is a very, very bad thing. A lot of people have been so dumbed down already, they're going to just follow like Pied Pipers. You know, wherever these mothers lead, they're just going to follow. Very bad thing. But certainly Ananda Mahima had this perfect certainty, totally normalized in her completely, the idea, didn't even see bodies, you know, she had spiritual perception constantly at all times, and just radiated this, hey, it's no problem, no worries at all. And that's like so valuable, you can't even put a value on it. Really, it just like irons out your concerns, irons out. You call the great iron, you know. She's like great iron, the great ironer. It just irons out the concerns without saying a word, not saying a word. The great gurus don't need to say a word. They just iron out your concerns simply because they're showing you it's completely okay. You know, no worries at all. It's all lovely. It's stable perception, effortless, lovely, lovingness, and I got no problems with it whatsoever, and you won't either. You know, that they're radiating this attitude and just irons out your concerns, just like that. So we're praying for such a guru, or gurus, absolutely, at this time. But, you know, the time is now, really. You can't wait any longer, you know. Otherwise, the wrinkles are going to get too problematical. So we need to have it ironed out right now, really, really seriously. When you start talking about, hey, all Americans all over the world, you're under alert. You know, that's a step away from, you know, martial law, as it were, almost. It really is saying we're telling you what to do all over the world. I mean, that's just like, you know. It's a gray area, right? But it certainly can breed a continuity with a type of martial law, a type of control, being told what to do, all right, by bureaucrats who have their own agenda as to why they're telling you what to do. They're not the Holy Spirit. But they want you to believe that they're acting in the interest of your salvation, and they're not. They're acting in the interest of trying to avoid salvation. Thinking that it is salvation, which is insanity. Insanity. The world is insane. Absolutely insane. It believes that by avoiding avoiding the continuity issue, by trying to make this world believe this is your home and will always be your home, that solves the continuity problem. That is insanity. Total insanity. And that's what the world runs on. And that's what you're being told, like, hey, this is your home. No, you can't go anywhere else. This is your home. Remember, this is your one and only home. That's what you'd be told, that you're going to be told. You have no other options. Shelter in place. You must stay where you are. You must follow authority. We will tell you what to do. Blah, 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 blah. That's what you're going to get. That's what you're going to get by the mother, you know, big mother, so to speak, and his mouthpieces. And this is insanity. Because it thinks, oh, we're being loyal to this world, therefore the continuity problem doesn't exist, because we're not going back home to reality, therefore we don't need to worry about disorientation, because we're not even going, we're never going to return to reality. So there's no continuity problem. We solved it. And of course, that's insanity, because this isn't our home. This is a completely futile hallucination, and we have no choice but to drop it and go home at some point eventually, right? So they didn't solve the continuity problem. The continuity problem is still there. It will always be there until it is resolved, and the perception of the steady perception of effortless, lovely lovingness of the Holy Spirit is the only way to resolve the continuity problem. And so that is sanity. It's practical, pragmatic, effective sanity. You see? That's the answer. Holy Spirit is the answer, not Big Mother. So, just process this, process it, process it, and say, okay, I've heard this, I've heard it. Stay level in your feelings, emotions. My feelings, emotions, level. No hatred going out. Good mood, humorous mood. Feel, you know, light mood. Nothing heavy in me as far as I feel how I feel or anything. And but at the same hand, very keen about, you know, hey, this situation. Okay, it's an intense, serious situation. Needs to be resolved. So, Guru, come. Hurry up. Really. Right away. Just don't need to say anything. Just show up. All right. Very great. Let's end this video. Thank you for watching. It's been a pleasure to present it. And again, reassurance. Keep your sense of humor. Even keel. And know that you're wise enough. There is the wisdom there. You have the capacity. And you know that in 10 seconds from now, you'll probably forget all about this. Just remember S.P.E.L.L. Stable perception, effortless, lovely loveliness. S.P.E.L.L. When you feel like you've lost what's been said here, you say, hey, I've fallen under a S.P.E.L.L. And then you go, hey, S.P.E.L.L. What a S.P.E.L.L. What a S.P.E.L.L. Yeah, I remember something. Stable perception, effortless, lovely loveliness. Oh, yeah. Holy Spirit, the perception of the Holy Spirit, that solves the continuity problem. And trying to make this world like we never our home, so we never go back to our true home, that's insanity. It doesn't solve the continuity problem. It's not a miracle at all. It's an avoidance. Oh yeah. Okay, so I need to, you know, so that starts your remembrance, right? S.P.E.L.L. Can you spell it? I've fallen under a S.P.E.L.L. I've forgotten what was said here. I've fallen under a S.P.E.L.L. S.P.E.L.L. Stable perception, effortless, lovely loveliness. Oh, yeah. Holy Spirit. Oh, yeah. I'm starting to remember now. So you need a lifeline like that, okay? So here's a lifeline. S.P.E.L.L. I've fallen under a S.P.E.L.L. As you're going about your work and everything, and you suddenly all just, you realize, whoa, I've completely forgotten my spiritual wisdom. What happened to me? I've fallen under a S.P.E.L.L. And then they say, wait a minute. S-P-E-L-L, what does that stand for? Stable perception, effortless, lovely loveliness. Oh, yeah. Click. You're right back there. Holy Spirit. Oh, yeah. Continuity problem. Oh, yeah. Comet. Oh, yeah. Guru. Presence of it's all okay. Oh, yeah. And then you're back in the game. Just like that. All right. S.P.E.L.L. S.P.E.L.L. Remember that one. Just that one word. You can do that as you go about your day. S.P.E.L.L. All right. Give it a try. Very great. That's it.